हेलो, वेलकम एवरीवन। तो आई होप यू आर डूइंग गुड। ओके, सो वेलकम एवरीवन। शिखा, भवानी, लोपामुद्रा, राजशेखर, खुशबू, पौलमी, सृष्टि, राहुल, प्रकाश, प्रियंका नायक, वेलकम एवरीवन। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट द सेशन। बिफोर दैट, इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन प्लीज फील फ्री टू आस्क द क्वेश्चन। आफ्टर दैट आई विल स्टार्ट। इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस सेशन, यू हैव एनी डाउट एनीथिंग, देन प्लीज आस्क द क्वेश्चन। इफ यू डोंट हैव द क्वेश्चन, यू प्लीज टाइप इन द चैट बॉक्स नो क्वेश्चन। No question. Okay, Shikha. Shikha, this is your first class, right? Shikha, yes. Okay, Rajshekhar, call me. So, to start with, first of all, I'll show you the complete overview. I'll show you the complete overview of how these sessions are going to go.
Recording in progress.
So basically, yeah, so can you hear me, everyone?
Yes, sir.
So in the current batch, we will be covering all the topics, and we are starting with the money and banking. So we have started with the money and banking, which is the most important chapter. And first, we started with the monetary policy developments. We covered all of these topics. Now we are covering these topic. In the last class, we discussed point number 2 and 3. Today we will cover Basel norms and counter cyclical capital buffer. And after that, we will start with the NPA. All about NPA. So this is the agenda for today, that is NPA. Then we will start with the RBI aspects, everything current affairs related to the RBI. Then we will come to the overall banking institution, nationalization, urban cooperative bank, small finance bank, merger of the banks. And finally, we will see the miscellaneous things and the e-payment, all of that. So in this manner, I think how many more sessions? 1, 2, 3. So apart from today, I think we'll take another 3 sessions. for completing this particular chapter. So this is the longest chapter and the most important also. So this is a complete overview how we are going to go. And now let's start today's session. Yeah, so please answer the questions on your screen. Please type the answer personally to my chat box. Don't answer to everyone, okay? Otherwise, other people get distracted. The question is very, very simple. So basically, regulatory consistency assessment program is basically with respect to the Basel norms. It is a program which assesses or which calculates how much is the consistency in the implementation of regulatory norms related to the Basel, right? So this is a very simple question. The answer is Basel norms, option A. Now comes the next question on your screen. Please read this question carefully and answer the question. Again, you should give the answer in the personal chat to me directly for me, Khushbu, Srishti, Rajshekhar. Okay, Rajshekhar, your answer is correct. Shekhar, your answer is also correct. So the answer to this question is option A. Option B is wrong because it is not in Bern, it is in Basel. So Basel is the name of place. Which country this place is? Basel, anyone?
Switzerland.
Sorry?
It's in Switzerland.
Okay. So the name of the place is Basel, that is why this answer is option A. Next question on your screen. Please again read the question carefully Yes, please.
Sir, in last question, sir, rather than 60, it will be 62, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, in the book also, it is 62.
Yes, sir, it's 62.
Okay, okay. Sorry, I'm really sorry. If you have verified, then I'm assuming you are correct. I will also verify it again, and I will let you know if it is 60 or 62. Okay, I will post on the Telegram channel. I'm assuming you are correct, okay, as of now. There can be a mistake from our side also. So, I'm giving the answer option D, assuming you are correct, okay? But still, I'll verify it once again. I'll post after the class. Please see this next question. Most of the answers are correct. Most of the answers are correct. So the correct answer is option D, 1, 2, and 3. Minimum capital, that is the capital adequacy ratio. Supervisory review process. And market discipline, right? We will discuss all of these very soon. So what is Basel norm? What is the meaning of Basel norm? So basically, so this is the news about regulatory consistency assessment program. Okay. Regulatory consistency assessment program. And it is basically checking how consistent the application of Basel committee recommendations is being done. Basel guidelines. These are the supervisory standards by the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision. And these are as per the Basel Accord. The main purpose is that in case of unexpected losses, the bank should be able to absorb the losses and they should be able to meet their obligations. So basically, banks are accepting demand deposits and term deposits from the customer. At times, it is possible that there can be crisis with the banks. So in the time of crisis, if all the customers turn around to the bank, it will become very stressful for the bank. So at that time, if bank is able to repay the amount to the customers, it builds the trust, right? So that is why there should be some minimum capital so that if customers start demanding the money, they can get it. There are three level of norms, three phases we can see. Basel I, which were introduced in 1988, and Basel II, 2004, Basel III, 2010. Right now, Basel III are in application, right? Basel II, you can say three type of risk: operational risk, market risk, and capital risk. Operational risk means the risk which can be there if the loans are not given to the correct person. So the risk in evaluating the credit worthiness of a customer. Market risk. For example, because of the COVID, the whole market is crashed. Capital risk. it can happen if there are so many like high amount of losses in the balance sheet, so it can lead to the capital losses. So it focuses on the three level of risk. The minimum capital required is 8% of the risk weighted asset. But in India, how much we follow? Anyone? How much we follow in India? 9%. So we are more conservative. We add 1% extra and we follow 9%, right? There are four parameters. So basically what happened in 2008, there was a financial crisis, which started from America, USA, where the big banks like America, Lehman Brothers, and so many other institutions, they fell down. So at that time, the new norms were introduced in 2010. So this was in the crisis, in the response to crisis of 2008, where many banks, they were collapsing. So here they introduced four vital banking parameters: the capital, the leverage, funding, and liquidity. Okay. So we will discuss, we have already discussed about the capital. Capital and funding both are almost same. Leverage is basically how much loan you are taking to run your operations, or how much risk you are taking. Liquidity is basically about the cash flow, right? So Basel is a city in the Switzerland, and here the Bank of International Settlement is located. So you can see there are three pillars of the Basel. Pillar one, that is the market capital requirement, which takes into account three kind of risk. The credit risk, market risk, operational risk. Supervisory review. Credit risk and capital risk both are same. Supervisory review, that is, there should be adequate review, regular review. And third is market discipline, that is disclosure, to allows banks adequacy to be compared with each other. So there should be disclosure and there should be comparison between the banks, so that the things can be checked at the market level, at the macro level, right? So this is capital adequacy 1, 2, and 3. So question one answer is A. Question two, as you are saying, I'm assuming your answer. Question three answer is D. Now please read this question carefully and give the answer. Everyone, please answer. Here we have 12 students. Everyone should answer. I have got how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Only 6 answers. Where are rest 6 people? Still only 6 answers. Lopamudra, Pavani, why are you not answering? Priyanka Nayak, Rupa. Please answer, everyone. This class is for everyone, okay? And this is an opportunity, okay? I am ensuring that you are simultaneously practicing the MCQs as well, right? If you are not aware, you can type NA. Not aware. The answer is option A. Statement one is correct. So statement one is correct. Statement two is wrong. Counter cyclical buffer is not a replacement. It is not a replacement. It is an extension. It is an extension of the capital conservation buffer. So what is capital conservation buffer? First, we should know that. Conservation is something we keep in reserve. Buffer means for emergency times. So we have kept some capital in the reserve for the emergency time, right? So during the normal time, जब आपका normal time होता है, उस समय क्या करते हैं हम? कुछ extra पैसे रख लेते हैं, so that if there is loss during the stress time, we can adjust this, right? That is capital conservation buffer. Normally, this is kept at 2.5% of risk weighted asset. And it is held in the form of common equity. Common equity means the shareholders' money, the equity capital, right? Counter-cyclical capital buffer, right? Counter-cyclical, it is to meet cyclical systematic risk when credit is growing rapidly. Then this type of buffer can be maintained, okay? And it can again be used whenever there is downturn in the economy, right? And it can range between 0% to 2.5%. It is an extension of the another buffer, okay? So this is not the replacement. It is in addition to the counter-cyclical capital buffer, right? So earlier, the RBI had put some timeline, but now it has deferred the implementation of CCYB. Answer is option A. Okay. Liquidity coverage ratio. What is liquidity? Liquidity means any cash or cash equivalent, right? Anything that can be converted into cash very easily, that is liquid. Okay. Coverage is that how many days of liquidity we have, or how many days of expenses our liquidity is able to cover. Okay. Suppose our daily expenses are 1000 rupees, right? And we have 40K rupees with the bank at one point of time. So our liquidity coverage ratio is 40:1. That is, we are able to cover 40 days expenses out of the given liquidity, right? So this is liquidity coverage ratio. As per the Basel III norms, every bank should have the high quality liquid assets. High quality means it can convert these assets into liquidity any point of time. Means it can go to the market and it can instantly generate the cash. So what can be the form of liquidity? It can be government securities. So government securities are always sellable. Gold is always sellable, right? As compared to the land. Land is not a liquid asset because not everyone may be ready to buy the land. Land is a very location specific thing. Land is not liquid, okay? But gold and all those things are liquid, okay? So as per the Basel III norm, the bank should keep at least 30 days liquidity, right? It is a kind of stress test so that in case there are any shocks, it can meet out and it can control any short-term liquidity disruptions, okay? So this is how we calculate high quality liquid asset amount. For example, 40K divided by total net cash flow amount daily. Suppose 1K. So So this comes to 40. Liquidity coverage ratio is 40. So the standard is 30 and we have 40. So this is good. Okay. Any questions so far out of this discussion? The capital adequacy and everything. So now we will take a break of 5 minutes and we will start at 8:35. We will start the NPA part. So the break of 5 minutes start now. Okay, so let's start. Prakash, you can share your question and we can discuss it later. NPA initiatives. So before we discuss about the NPA initiatives, let's see. The meaning of NPA, right? Non-performing asset. So if an asset is stop performing, it is called a non-performing asset. What is the meaning of stop performing? Asset means anything which can give the income. In case of bank, the income is the interest on the loan or the recovery of the loan. So if either the interest is stopped or the recovery, that is a repayment installment, is stopped by the customer, in any of these two cases, if it continues for more than 90 days, then that particular loan is classified as the non-performing asset. So this is the definition of the non-performing asset. For different categories of loan, this non-performing asset is different, right? So for example, for agricultural loan, it depends upon the number of season, right? So for different category of loan, there can be a little bit variation, but overall the funda is, if there is a default in the interest payment or the principal payment and this default continues for 90 days or more, then it will be classified as a non-performing asset. What is the implication of the classification, right? So does classification mean now customer will start paying the loan? No, right? हमने उसको NPA declare कर दिया, इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि customer उसको repay करना शुरू कर देगा. It just means that now we have to start process of recovery and we have to stop recognition of the income in our books. तो अब हम जो उसका interest आने वाला था, उसको हम अपने income नहीं मान के चलेंगे और हम recovery के step लेना शुरू कर देंगे, right? We will become more serious about the recovery. This is the purpose of classification of the bank loan into the NPA, right? So, loan made is an asset. Any loan given by the bank is an asset. So, if it is not producing any income, either in the form of interest or the principal repayment, and it continues for 90 days or more, then it is NPA, right? And this is the news. RBI is saying the GNPA ratio could worsen because of the COVID-19, right? Even the mudra loans, they are turning bad over the last 3 years. So for different category of loans, we can see, for example, for the term loan, it is interest and or, so either or both of them. So if the installment is being repaid but the interest is not being repaid, then also this is NPA. Overdraft or cash credit, normally it happens in case of the business. So businessmen, they take some overdraft, they withdraw the money in excess to their own account balance. So if that is not returned back within the 90 days, okay, bill purchased, bill discounted, we discuss in the chapter of banking, where, you know, some bills are discounted by the customer from the bank and it is not repaid within 90 days, then it also, like, it is remains overdue. Overdue means if suppose the the due date of payment was 31st of March. So after 31st of March,
we will again count 90 more days, right? So 90 days will not be counted from the original date of the bill. They will be counted from the due date. That is why this is called overdue. इसके लिए हम इसको क्या बोलते हैं? Overdue बोलते हैं, right? Crop loan in case of short term long crops, two crop season. In case of long term crops, it is one crop season. Okay. Principal or interest. Principal or interest. Okay. So it can be any of them. Yeah. If you see the overall categorization of the NPA, the assets basically, not the NPA, the overall categorization of the assets of the bank. So these are the various categories.
So assets or the loans, they can be classified into standard asset. So a loan can be a standard asset. A loan is a standard asset, right? It is a normal asset if there is no delay. But if there is a delay between 1 day to 90 days, we call it stressed asset. मतलब stress का मतलब है कि अभी stress आना शुरू हो चुका है. The chances that this loan will not be repaid,
so that is why this is called stressed asset. Now the stressed assets, they are classified into three categories. The special mention account zero if the overdue period is 1 to 30 days. By the way, why we are classifying this? So this is not NPA. Please understand. This is not NPA. This is not NPA. This is not NPA, right? But we are classifying this into special mention account. What is the meaning of special mention? That now the bank will start special focus on these loans and we start noticing that why are they defaulting? Even if they are not NPA, right? We will not follow the strict process of recovery and all, but bank will become aware. It will become alert that yes, these are the loans which have started defaulting. Let's speak to them why they are defaulting. If default is between 31 to 60 days, it is one SMA one, and between 61 to 90 days, it is SMA two. More than 90 days, it will automatically become NPA. Now NPA can also be divided into three categories. The initial stage of the NPA is substandard asset. The next stage is doubtful asset. And the final stage, loss assets. So up to 12 months, NPA banne ke baad 12 mahine tak usko substandard bolte hain hum log. After 12 months, we call it doubtful asset. And after, like if it is non-recoverable, like the businessman is no longer running the business, it is the businessman is bankrupt, or there is something mishappening, for example fire, flood, anything. So in such cases the loan is unrecoverable. Now what is the purpose of classifying the NPA into these three categories? Why we are classifying the NPA into these three categories? Because if they are classified into these three categories, then we can accordingly focus upon the more serious NPA, and we can actually make the provision. Provision means we can start providing for some cushion, some reserve, that in case these loans do not recover, we should not feel a shock. So we will start accumulating the amount equal to certain percentage of this NPA. And we will not give this amount to the shareholders. We will not distribute this amount to the shareholder as the profit, right? So the ultimate purpose is to stop the distribution of the profit to the owners, so that in case these loans do not recover, the bank should not get a shock, right? So reserve is made, the provision is made. Okay, now there is a
recording in progress.
there is a word which is called stressed assets, which includes three things: the NPA, the restructured loans, and the written off assets. So NPA is that we have discussed, something which is overdue for 90 days or more, and is restructured loans. That means those loans for which the NPA have been restructured. For example, the customer says that, sir, I cannot repay them within 1 year. Please provide me four extra years. So it is extension of the time period. It is restructuring. Or customer says, sir, I can't give you 10% of interest rate. Please allow me 5% discount. I can give only 5% discount, 5% interest rate. That is also one type of restructuring. So to make the process of recovery viable for the consumer, the bank is able to give some relaxation that is called restructuring of the loan. Written off assets means the assets which have been, you know, declared as non-recoverable and bank has written off from the books. Bank ne bol diya ki abhi paise nahi aane wale hain. ठीक है, although this does not extinguish the bank's right to recover the loan from the customer. इसका मतलब कस्टमर की लायबिलिटी खत्म नहीं हुई है. ठीक है, सपोज सम स्टूडेंट टेक्स एडमिशन इन माय कोर्स, जस्ट अंडरस्टैंड हाउ इट वर्क्स. सपोज सम स्टूडेंट रजिस्टर्स इन द प्रोग्राम ऑफ एकेडमी, द कोर्स फीस इज से 50,000 रुपीज. नाउ आउट ऑफ 50,000 रुपीज द स्टूडेंट पेज 25,000 रुपीज. 25,000 is pending, but after following up for a long time, we found that this amount will not be coming to us. So what we do, we reduce our profit of 25,000, or we reduce our revenue of 25,000. We say that okay, this amount is not going to come, right? So we will not consider this as a profit. We will write off the asset. We will light off our right, okay? But it does not mean that a student is not liable to pay. We can run a legal suit against the customer. We can always go against the customer in the court of law. We can recover the money. But in our financial books, we will show that money is not recoverable, okay? Because we work on the principle of prudency. We work on the principle of conservation. Prudency means we are prudent. We assume the losses, but we don't assume the profit, right? If there is a chance of loss, we will say, yes, loss is going to come. So let us provide for the loss. Let us be more alert about the loss. But if profit is there, we will be doubting. Profit hai ki nahi hai? Profit hoga, tabhi hum recover karenge. Theek hai? Toh, ye hota hai, return of assets. Now, what is the difference between restructuring, provisioning, and write-off? Can anyone tell? I'm going a bit deeper, okay? So you should not worry in case you're not able to understand on the first go. That means you're not able to recall, but yeah, there are chances, two chances that question can come. Anyone please share difference between restructuring, provisioning, and write-off. Yeah. Restructuring I have already shared, okay? Restructured in the terms and conditions. Maybe interest rate. Or repayment period. Okay. Provisioning is in the books of the bank. In the bank's books, we are providing for. Providing for means we are setting aside certain percentage of the loan
of the NPA out of our profit. जो हमारा profit है, bank का जो profit है, उसमें से कुछ amount हम set aside कर देते हैं. हम बोलते हैं कि ये amount हम side में कर देते हैं, क्योंकि हो सकता है future में हमें losses हो. It is a possibility that in the future the money may not be recovered from the customer. So in that case, we will adjust that non-recovery from this amount of provision. Okay, so this is called provision. Provision is the kind of reserve, some amount that we have kept aside from the profit. Write-off. Write-off is, as I told you, suppose the bank is not able to recover the loan of 25,000 rupees. So it will cut out this loan from its book. Someone has muted. Unmuted, sorry. Prakash. Yeah. So अपने बुक से इसको खत्म कर दिया. प्रोविजनिंग में, इन केस ऑफ प्रोविजनिंग, देर इज नो राइट ऑफ. द लोन विल स्टिल एग्जिस्ट इन द बैंक बुक. ओके, बट इन केस ऑफ राइट ऑफ, द लोन विल नॉट बी एग्जिस्टिंग इन द बुक्स ऑल्सो. दे विल नॉट बी विजिबल इन द बुक्स. बुक्स में लिखा ही नहीं होगा कि ये लोन भी हमने कुछ दिया हुआ है. ठीक है. यस प्रकाश, यू आर राइट. Provision is a kind of buffer, and written off means it has taken away from, it has been taken away from the books. Absolutely. So, and what is the meaning of write down? Write off means 100%. Write down means less than 100%. Writing down the value. Okay. Now, various channels of recovery of the NPA: Lok Adalat, Debt Recovery Tribunal, RPC Act, IBC, right? And if you see majority of the loans, they are recovered through two processes, that is the SARFAESI and the IBC. Okay. Now the concept of inter-creditor agreement. Okay. So creditor here means banks. Banks are the institutions who give the loan. So they are the creditor. They have given the credit. Okay. So the banks are the creditors. Inter-creditor means among the banks. Agreement means there is some kind of understanding. So the banks have some kind of understanding among them. In case their common borrower defaults. So there is a person, Mr. A, he has taken the loan from various banks, right? So if one bank comes to know that Mr. A is defaulting, he can contact with other banks and he can tell them that this person is going to default. Let's come together and let us recover the money that is due from Mr. A, right? So it's a kind of joint effort to recover the NPA. So inter-creditor agreement is aimed at resolution of the loan account with the size of 50 करोड़ और अबव. ठीक है, तो छोटे मोटे अमाउंट की बात नहीं करते हैं. ठीक है, 50 करोड़ एंड अबव की बात करते हैं. दैट इज अंडर द कंट्रोल ऑफ ए ग्रुप ऑफ लेंडर. दिस मनी हैज बीन गिवन बाय द ग्रुप ऑफ लेंडर. ओके, इसको हम बोलते हैं कंसोर्शियम लेंडिंग. ओके, सो इन केस वन बैंक इज नॉट विलिंग टू गिव द लोन टू द कस्टमर अलोन, देन द ग्रुप ऑफ बैंक कैन कम टुगेदर एंड दे कैन गिव द लोन जॉइंटली. सो इन दैट केस दिस इज कॉल्ड कंसोर्शियम बेस्ड लेंडिंग. So in case of consortium-based lending, if the loan size is 50 crore or more, then this is done. It is part of the Sashakt plan, which was there to address the problem of resolving bad debt. And Sunil Mehta committee it recommended. Okay. Now please read this very carefully, quickly.
What is the meaning of exposure here? Srishti, you are asking this question. If 66% or 2/3 of the lender in terms of aggregate exposure, here exposure means basically the aggregate risk, aggregate amount of risk, right? So for example, I say State Bank of India is exposed to the risk of 50 crore by paying loan to the Vijay Mallya. That is the exposure, okay? The total amount of the loan, right? Procedure for ICA. You can read this. This is self-explanatory. No need to discuss here. You can read it later. This is very simple and nothing special here. Now, prudential framework for resolution of stressed assets. This is important. Please work on this question. Okay, Shikha, you have no idea about it, not a problem. Call me. Answer is wrong. Prakash, answer is wrong. Khushbu, your answer is correct. Rahul, yours also. Lopamudra, yours also. No, Anomitra. The answer is option A. Why the answer is option A? Why option B is wrong? The form of brother for 30 days default rule for the lenders. This is not borrower. This is lender. Till in stay. Read the question carefully. Okay. You'll make this kind of mistake. Next question, please. On your screen. So far, none of you have given the correct answer. Only one correct answer I got from Prakash. Told me you are also correct. Okay. Okay, so we will discuss the answer later. Let us first see what is this. Prudential framework. As I already told, what is the meaning of prudency? Prudence means that we are alert in advance. That is prudency. Framework is a set of guidelines for resolution of the stressed assets. Right? Stressed assets. So, issued by the RBI, it is a set of guidelines to deal with the bad loans, especially with respect to the large borrowers. छोटे बोरोवर को तो बैंक खुद ही संभाल लेते हैं, लेकिन बड़ी मशीनरी को संभालने के लिए आरबीआई को आना पड़ता है. तो अर्लियर व्हाट यूज्ड टू हैपन इन द 2018 रूल, इवन इफ देयर वाज वन डे डिफॉल्ट, द बैंक हैव टू टेक द स्ट्रिक्ट एक्शन एंड हैज टू कम अप विद अ रिजोल्यूशन प्लान कि कैसे इसको संभालेंगे. राइट, बिकॉज इन फ्रॉम 2010 टू 2017-18, there were a lot of NPAs. So RBI became very, very strict. RBI said that even if there is a one-day default, RBI ने बोला कि भाई अगर एक भी दिन default होता है तब भी आपको हमें एक resolution plan बना के देना होगा कि आप कैसे इस bank इस NPA को resolve करने जा रहे हैं. And it has to be implemented in the 180 days time from the first default. Okay. But because of this, the problem started happening, because at some times, one day is very, very short time. It can happen by mistake, or if not mistake, but you know, there should be some breathing space to the borrower, okay, and to the lender. Therefore, 30 days time is being given, okay, instead of one day. So earlier, if there was a default by the large borrower, after one day only, the borrower, the lender has to come up with the resolution plan to be implemented within 180 days. Now, this resolution plan has to be started, you know, it has to be framed up within 30 days, right? So this is the breathing space for whom? For the lender, because lender is to prepare the resolution plan, okay? Answer is option A, because this is also applicable to the NBFCs, right? Scheduled commercial banks, financial institutions like NABARD, SFBs, systematically important NBFCs and deposit taking NBFCs, they are also part of the group of institutions who have to apply this, right? So it is applicable on the NBFC. The answer is option A, right? Prudential framework, you can read it yourself. I think it is self-explanatory. Set of guidelines. Framework means set of guidelines. The principle is early recognition and reporting of default. Because in case of large borrower, we can't wait for the 90 days. 90 days ho jayenge, default kar lenge, uske baad sochenge. Tab tak to wo foreign pahunch jayenge. Hai ki nahi hai? Complete discretion to the lender with respect to design and implementation. They can make their own plan. Kisko resolve kaise karna hai, right? Harmonized framework. So earlier there used to be multiple schemes like S4A, SDR, 525. Now these have all been suspended. Okay. So answer option A, this is the breathing space for the lender. Okay, so next question on your screen, please read it carefully. Take your time. Rahul, take your time. Okay, so answer is option D. All of three are correct. Prompt corrective action. Corrective means something is to be restored which has been done wrong. Prompt means quickly. Framework means set of guideline. Action means the actions have been taken by the respective bank. So this is a set of guideline by the RBI when one of the bank is a weak because of high amount of NPA. It is put under the scrutiny by the RBI. It was introduced in 2002, but it was very much highlighted in the 2017 because of the high amount of NPAs at that time. So it provides for early intervention and resolution. And what are the indicators? There are three parameters. The capital ratio, that is the capital adequacy ratio, asset quality, that is the risk weighted assets, profitability, right? So there are certain parameters. If those parameters are not fulfilled, if those benchmarks are not fulfilled in these three parameters, then it is to be implemented. Importance, so that there is early intervention to prevent the bigger crisis. Would a bank collapse now? Yes, bank collapse hua. Agar isko timely sambhal liya hota, to baat ye alag hoti. Monitoring key financial performance indicator. Yehi to key financial indicator hai. Prevent the bank failure, and banks are the systematic institutions. They impact the entire economy, right? They are the systematic institutions. It can lead to the systematic failure, systematic crisis. So it is a mandatory action plan. Okay. Mandatory hai. Isme koi bank ki choice nahi hai. Kya impact kya hoga? If these three financial indicators are in stress, what will be the impact? Impact can be stop distributing the profit. Apne shareholder ko profit dena band kijiye. Pehle bank ko bachaiye. Okay. Bring more capital. Jyada capital leke aaiye. Right. Don't expand the branches. Hire provisioning. What is provisioning? Setting aside certain percentage of loan out of the profits. Ab aapko jyada profit block karne padenge. Restriction on the management compensation. ऐसा नहीं है कि यस बैंक के राणा साहब वो करोड़ों रुपए अपने घर लेके जाएंगे सैलरी के रूप में. ऐसा नहीं होगा. Okay. Lot of banks were put under this. UBI, IOB, CBI, IDBI, and so many banks. Okay. Central bank object karta hai kyun? Because it can lead to the lesser loan to the industries and MSMEs, and it can hit the investment and the economic growth. This is the reason why central bank sometimes, you know, creates resistance. So answer is option D. Now, what is supervisory action framework? Yes, please.
Sir, there was that term tier 1 leverage ratio, sir. Ye to usme nahi tha, sir. Uske jo teen conditions parameters the.
PCA framework deems banks as risky if they slip some trigger points, capital risk weighted assets, net NPA, ROA, and tier 1 leverage ratio. Okay. So basically, this asset quality, na, this asset quality, one of the parameters is this leverage ratio, tier 1 leverage ratio. Ye thoda technical mein diya hua hai. Here, technical details yahan pe nahi di hui hai. Right? Yeah. So CRAR, net NPA, return on assets. This return on assets is the profitability. Hai na? CRR, CRAR is the capital requirement, net NPA, and tier 1. This is the asset quality. Okay. So capital, asset quality, and profitability. Now next is the supervisory action framework. This is similar action. Like for the banks, we have prompt corrective action framework. Similarly, for the cooperative banks, we have supervisory action framework. It is exactly same. Okay, exactly same. So it is PCA is applicable to the commercial banks, not to the cooperative banks or NBFCs. You have to remember this point. Okay, so prudential norms are applicable to the NBFCs, but not the PCA framework. Parameters remain the same, and it can also be initiated in case of serious governance issues, because in case of cooperative banks, this governance problem is also there. A lot of time there is a governance crisis because state government, they are appointing the people, the management people. So there can be various other restrictions on the dividend, donation, new loans, capital expenditure, etc. Now, next question is with respect to SARFAESI Act. Now we will discuss the SARFAESI Act. Please answer. इसका आंसर सभी लोगों का ठीक आ रहा है. आंसर इज ऑप्शन ए. इट डज नॉट कवर नॉन सिक्योर्ड लोन. इट कवर्स ओनली सिक्योर्ड लोन. राइट. SARFAESI एक्ट, हाउ डज दिस वर्क? So any bad loan, this bad loan is given by the bank to the asset reconstruction company. What is asset reconstruction company? It's a company which takes over the bad loan from various banks and which recovers them from the borrower. So it's an effective tool to recover the NPAs, and it is applicable only in case there is an underlying security. The customer has given the security to the bank. For example, it has put its land or its vehicle, its home, at a mortgage, as the mortgage. Following are the main objectives of the SARFAESI. Provide the legal framework for securitization activities. What is securitization? I will tell you very soon. Transfer of NPA to asset reconstruction companies for the reconstruction. I will explain this point very soon. Without court intervention, this is very important. Enforcing the security interest. That means it will recover the loan by selling of the property without going to the court. So before the SARFAESI, what used to happen? The bank used to go to the customer and say, "Hum aapka property bech karke loan recover karne wale hain." The customer will go to the court and will say, "Sir, ye mere baap dada ka makan hai. This is my forefather's house. I have been living here for centuries. My family is been emotionally attached. Please don't attach this property. Please don't sell this property." Or the judges, they are a bit emotional. They will say, okay, we will stop the bank. They will not go to your home. They will not recover the money. Okay, you pay as per your convenience. So the court intervened. So this created a problem in the recovery. Therefore, in 2002, this act says the bank is not supposed to go to the court. Court will not intervene. Court can intervene at the later stage if the process of the SARFAESI Act is not followed. But it cannot stop the banks from recovering the amount. That is why this recovery can take place. Otherwise, the recovery can never take place. Right? So it gives the power to the bank and the financial institutions to take over the immovable property that is pledged to enforce the recovery. So immovable property means house, land, plot. So the major feature is the ARC and asset securitization. So what is securitization? Just give me a minute. Yeah, so how this process of securitization works, let us see here. This is SBI. This is Asset Reconstruction Company. SBI has NPAs of 1,000 rupees. This is PNB. This has NPAs of 500 rupees. This is ICICI. It has NPAs of 200 rupees. So all of them, they sell their NPA at a discount to the asset reconstruction company. At a discount means this ARC will give, suppose, 800 rupees to the SBI instead of 1,000, 400 instead of 500, and suppose 160 rupees instead of 200. Well, this is a hypothetical figure. So it will not give the full amount because it has to recover the money. It has to recover the money and it has to put some effort. It has to spend some money. So it will recover the cost from the bank only, right? Now, how this ARC is going to fund this amount. So ARC has to pay 8 plus 4 plus 160. 8 plus 4 plus 1.6. 1360 rupees ARC has to give to the SBI, PNB and ICICI. How to arrange this money? ARC, it will go to the investors in the open market and it will say, I have a pool of assets. Okay. And I have purchased them at 1360, but I will recover from them. How much? 1700. So you invest the money into my company and this profit of how much? 340 rupees. I will share with you people. So investors will start investing into the asset reconstruction company. The name of the company, Asset Reconstruction. What is the meaning of asset here? Asset means the loan. This loan is the asset for the bank like SBI, PNB and ICICI. Reconstruction means it is reconstructing, means these loan are being represented as an asset, a pool of asset to the investor. And it's a company, right? So this is asset reconstruction company, which is converting these bad loan into the assets and offering to the investor that we will recover the money. Please pay the money. It will recover, it will take the money from the investor, will pay to the banks. It will follow the process. It is expert and it will make the profit. Is it clear how this process works? The process of securitization. Now you can relate this. Securitization is the practice of pooling together various type of debts. Instruments such as mortgage, consumer loan, bahut sare tarah ke loan hote hain, and selling them as bond to the investor. Unko investor ko bond bana ke bech diya. Theek hai? Asset reconstruction is the process of converting a bad loan into a performing asset with the help of asset reconstruction company. Clear everyone? We have seen the process. The process is very simple. Now, without court, enforcement of security without court. This is crucial, right? Now you can see, you can read this later on. Yeah. Now, why this was in news? So this was in news because Supreme Court held that cooperative banks established under the state law. So cooperative banks are established under the state law, right? Or under the multi-state cooperative societies. They will be coming under the SARFAESI Act also, right? So earlier there was an understanding that cooperative bank will not come under the SARFAESI, but now even the cooperative bank, the secured loan of the cooperative bank, that is also covered under the SARFAESI, right? So earlier there were conflicting decision by the high courts. High court ke decision the, high court ne bola tha, in one of the case they say that the question is whether cooperative bank are the banks under the Banking Regulation Act, because this is applicable, this SARFAESI Act is applicable for the Banking Regulation Act only. The second, they raised a question whether the parliament has the legislative competence, because this cooperative bank, they are under the state law. So can the parliament make a law to regulate these cooperative banks which are working under the state law? So it is a matter of parliament having the legislative competence or not, right? So there was an argument that if under the list one and list two of the seventh schedule, as per the constitution, if there is already a valid law by the state, there cannot be another law by the parliament on the same topic. So if cooperative bank are being regulated by the state government, then regulation of the central government cannot work. That was the point of high courts. But Supreme Court has reversed all of this, and Supreme Court is saying cooperative banks, they come are within the definition of banks as per the Banking Regulation Act for the purpose of SARFAESI Act. Right? Therefore, it is applicable. The SARFAESI Act is applicable, right? And the parliament has the legislative competence. Okay, we are not supposed to go into the deep of this, but we have to just understand that yes, it can be done. It is possible, right? So with this, we complete this particular topic. We have some more topics in the NPA, couple of more topics, three, four more topics. We'll continue this with this moratorium and all of these export emergency credit line guarantee and small other topics will continue in the next class. Okay. So next class will happen on most probably on Tuesday, coming Tuesday, right? Any question? Please ask me if you have any question. Any question? Did you enjoy the session, everyone?